Alrighty. Hi. Welcome. Welcome so much. Thank you so much for being here. It's such a busy point in the semester. I am thrilled that you are all here. I'm Dr. Marah Gubar. I'm a professor in the literature section here at MIT. And I'm assistant director of the MIT Communications Forum, which is sponsoring this event. And I am so excited to welcome you guys here for a conversation about all things tween. So I'll start by explaining the format of the Comm Forum for those of you who have not been here. We will have 1 hour of moderated conversation. I will ask questions of our panelists, who I will introduce in a second. I'm so excited they are here to join us. And after that, at 6, we will pause for a second, and any of you who need to run should feel free at that point to exit the room. Don't feel abashed. We understand. But for the rest of you, from 6 to 7, we will have an opportunity for you to ask questions of our panelists, and those are what those microphones are for, so that when we conclude, I'll ask you to step up to the microphones and get in line, and you can ask your questions at the microphone. Okay, so that's a note about format. And now I can introduce our two wonderful panelists who work on youth culture. I'm so excited they are here. First, we have Dr. Meryl Alper. She's an assistant professor of communication studies at Northeastern University. And before that, she actually worked on the production end of tween culture. She worked at places like Nickelodeon and Disney, so we're definitely going to talk to her about that. And now that she's a professor, she's also a faculty associate at the Berkman Klein Center for Internet and Society at Harvard. And she's the author of 2 books. One is out and the other forthcoming, I think. The first one is Digital Youth with Disabilities, and it came out from our own MIT Press in 2014. And the one she's still working on that's gonna come out is called Giving Voice, Mobile Communication, Disability and Inequality, and that's coming out also from MIT, so you must have had a good experience the first time. Okay, good, in 2017. So that's Dr. Alper. Then we have Dr. Tyler Bickford, who is an assistant professor at the University of Pittsburgh. His PhD was actually in music. He's an ethnomusicologist, but he got a job at the English department of the University of Pittsburgh because they have one of the top children's literature and culture programs in the country. And his first book,
I got a job because Marah wanted to hire me.
I used to work at Pitt, but that is not why he got the job. He got the job because he was the best candidate and so exciting to have in the program. His first book is in production now, right?
Yeah.
At Oxford
May 1.
Oh my God! At Oxford University Press, and it's called Schooling New Media: Music, Language, and Technology in Children's Culture. And he's also working on a second book entitled Tween Pop. I love that title, obviously. Children's Music and the Public Sphere. So we need to ask him about Justin Bieber, Miley Cyrus, Hannah Montana, all of whom he has written articles about. And also this year, to finish his Tween Pop book, he has an ACLS fellowship, which is a really fancy, prestigious, awesome fellowship. So they are our panelists. I'm so excited they're here. And so I think first we should just start with the basics and say, and I'll ask, what does it mean to be a tween?
I'll let you go.
Where does the term come from? What does it mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those are surprisingly big questions, I think. So the simple version, the sort of everyday version, is that tweens are in between children and teenagers, right? And so kids 8 to 12 years old, maybe. But the problem, the reason it's not a simple question, is that the history of that is sort of very complex. We used to have other words like preteen or subteen. So why we changed, you know, the language we use.
Microbopper.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right?
Like this
poster.
Amazing poster, Esquire magazine. And
that was 1968.
Right.
Microbopper.
So I think maybe the thing to emphasize is that tween has always been a marketing category, right? So it's a demographic category for marketers in the consumer industries and media industries. It comes from that world. Whereas words like preteen maybe less so, right? Like they also may have had sort of marketing implications. But tween has always been a marketing category, and the kind of 8 to 12 that maybe it stabilized at never totally was fixed. And if you look at marketing literature from companies that identify as marketing to tweens, you can go very low and very high, right? So ranges that might bottom out at literally at preschool and end up as high as like 15 years old. Or there might be sort of ranges that overlap. So 5 to 11 might be what one person defines as tween, and another person might define 12 to 15 as tween, right? And those don't overlap at all. So it ends up being a sort of capacious category, especially because of some of the way that the ways that the market evolved.
And when did the marketers start using it, though? Tween in particular.
So I think that there's a, to sort of just take a step back, all this has to do with sort of a larger conversation about how we define youth.
Yeah.
And, you know, thinking about how do young people of a certain age spend their time and what they have time to do outside of the things they must do. What do they choose to do? What do they have to do? So we think about distinctions between who has to work, who doesn't have to work, who has to go to school, who doesn't have to go to school, and when is it legally mandated that people go to school, and not just when in sort of our history, but where in the world. So in the United States, you at age 11, you are supposed to be in school. Around the world, that might be the time that you might go to work. So a sort of cultural that we're part of the, it's always been a certain way or hasn't been a certain way, certainly a sort of global perspective on any of this and around sort of the rights of kids to do stuff with their time, like go shopping or buy stuff, kind of, I think, needs to be framed a little bit out in sort of what we're looking at. And then to sort of riff off the sort of age bands, you're right, it definitely does sort of, I think, bounce off of who's talking about for what purpose to sell what. So for Nielsen ratings, it's 6 to 11. So when I was, working at Disney Channel, you'd get bands for 2 to 5, 6 to 11, 2 to 11, and then older kids too. But sort of that's what the advertising was being centered around. And so that's what you would then sort of communicate to the Nielsen marketers. So we can say sort of, not yet teenagers or emerging teenagers. Nowadays we have a emerging adulthood. So adolescents who aren't quite adults. But we don't use that term emerging teenager, and I don't know why exactly. It's kind of a mouthful, but we could, maybe.
Oh, I will take this moment to say we have a sign-in sheet over there if you would like to be on the Comm Forum mailing list. So as you go out, you can sign your name and your email address to be on the Comm Forum mailing list so that you know about events like these before they happen if you're not already on it. All right, I'm just going to keep going.
So can I follow up?
Because
I think the point about over time and across geographies that sort of how we think about youth and childhood changes a lot is an important one. So I think as a reservation when we, like, not every 11-year-old is a tween, right? So tween isn't something that exists in the world that we go out and find. Tween is an idea that marketers had, right? And that they started using this term in order to sort of define and categorize. So even in the United States, where childhood might be very different than in other parts of the world, or in the contemporary United States, where it might be very different than other parts of history, other times in history, that the idea of tween is a concept and it's not a group of people, right? So it's not a sociological phenomenon. It's a sort of cultural, conceptual idea about how people sort of might be or should be that really is in the minds of marketers and spreads out from there rather than being sort of in the world in actual 11-year-olds that marketers are jumping into.
So let me ask then, once that happened, it became this cultural category that adults were using, that marketers were using. Did people in that category sort of grab onto it and have a sense like, yes, we are tweens? Like, do tweens, is tweens something that tweens think of themselves as now?
So I think that we have two things. So tweens, people between sort of early adolescence are always trying to figure out who they are and are very concerned with age bracketing. But those definitions are very much shaped by their social context. So it might be the difference between being on one kind of basketball team or another kind of basketball team that you get to age into. And those children are the little kids and those are the older kids. But if you ask then the high schoolers, they'd all be little kids. But they're really into figuring out how they belong and who they belong to and who they belong with. And I think that those micro boring interactions, they don't have a market value attached to them. That those in-group, out-group kids are themselves sort of anthropologists of sort of what what items do they use to mark who they belong to and who they belong with? What do they use to purposefully exclude people and create those groups? So I think that the it's much more interesting to then also think about in what ways they might adapt what is labeled as tween culture to do that demarcation work, to do that belonging, not belonging work. So it's not to say that they're like above or outside of it, but they certainly appropriate it to do that work.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think the term itself, right, is it used by kids who might fit its criteria? It probably never caught on the way that words like teenager caught on, right? So teenager is an invention of the kind of post-war era. That word was not widely used earlier, and it sort of spread very quickly, and people who fit the, you know, numerical category started calling themselves teenagers, and now that's a sort of widespread word. I think tween is not that, right? I think tweens, you know, words like preteen still do circulate. And so I think one of the interesting things about this kind of experience of being kind of older than a child and younger than a teenager is that it is really ambiguous, and there is a lot of different language that you can use, and a lot of, like, one of the reasons that a word like tween can come into being is because people are trying to figure out, you know, what this time of life is. Parents are asking questions about it. Kids themselves are asking questions about it. Marketers are asking questions about it. So some of this is throwing things against the wall and seeing what sticks. I think parents might say my tween is, right, to describe their 11-year-old kid. And you might find kids less, but sometimes using that word. But I think kids are more likely to use the word kid to describe themselves, right, and to be very sensitive, like you say, to these micro, right? Like, kids are often very clear about who's younger than them and who's older than them, sort of where they fit in a kind of age hierarchy, which sometimes labels like tween might be helpful for, but other times it might not.
Mm-hmm. Or they might just, you know, they go to the store and they see, oh, that's the tween clothing section.
Right.
So it's been, you know, clearly marketed for them. So, you know, knowing that certain objects that they might be into are labeled, I think they have an awareness of, not as if they're sort of unaware of it, but self-identification is sort of a different thing.
And why did the marketers create it? What was in it for them?
I mean, I think part of that is that you have income. You have kids with spending power, with parents who, and so we should sort of unpack this even further and to say that there is a gendered component, a class component, a racial component to who is desired as the market and who's constructed as the market and who gets symbolized as being, marketed to. So I think that there's been really interesting work by Allison Pugh, who's a sociologist, and Elizabeth Chin, who's done really interesting work on going to stores with kids who lower socioeconomic backgrounds, kids of color, to sort of figure out when you go to a store, do you feel like this stuff is for you? And how do you make meaning of that stuff? And I think that the sort of exclusionary kind of boundaries that are created around tween culture do that other work of sort of who belongs as part of a tween and who doesn't belong in that category.
So you're saying that the category tween is gendered and raced.
Well, from the get-go, actually, I remember reading that sort of the like tween teen first emerged around sort of beauty tips. That was sort of as a way of sort of, you know, it's not teen, you know, makeup, but tween teen sort of makeup. So that, like, actually having a sort of gendered component from the get-go and a commercial component and a sort of aesthetic component as well. So that sort of tracing through.
And generally, we have a sense, right, that when we segregate the market, that creates more and more little niches,
right,
you can
mm-hmm.
sell people things to.
Mm-hmm.
Is that kind of...
So, and I think, so historically in the 20th century, right, you have the emergence of, like, the children's consumer market in the 20s and 30s and 40s, right, where previously you don't have that, right? You have department stores, but there isn't a separate section for children. And so you start to have, like, Daniel Cook at Rutgers wrote a book about the history of this. You start to have sections specifically for mothers and then sections which end up being sections that are sort of about young children. So you have the young children's, like, clothing market and toy market get consolidated, and marketers start thinking about toddlers and mothers as consumers. And then in the post-war period, you have teenagers, right, get consolidated and marketed to. It's interesting in that time when you're looking at youth culture developing and Elvis and the Beatles, right? If you look at the videos of the Beatles coming to the States, there's lots of 11-year-old girls in those videos screaming for the Beatles, right? But they're named teenagers, right? Like the sort of language that exists is teen. And so, right, so you're segmenting a market, there's this kind of inexorable logic of consumer markets to kind of try and segment them. Marketers have an interest in divining new niches to sell to them. And so it makes sense if you're targeting youth, you know, you have very young people, you have teenagers, and then if you want to segment that even more, you kind of divide out the space in between. And historically, that starts to happen in the 80s. So there is kind of a timeline here that makes sense just from a kind of market logic. Right?
Yeah, that does make sense. So what kinds of, if you had to say what the sort of cultural stereotype of the tween is, I feel like we're moving towards defining it already, but what would you say about the sort of the cultural stereotype of who or what a tween is based on the culture that's coming out for them, how they're represented in it?
It's funny, I think when that question, I more think about colors. Like purposely, I think about and that sort of gendered component, pinks, purple, sort of glitter, sparkly. you know, there's always a store at the mall that like tends to be sort of labeled as the tween sort of store. I think nowadays it's Justice is, but maybe a generation or a little bit ago, I see some nods. Limited 2 might have been the tween store. I see more nods. Like you knew that was the store to get tween stuff and to see other tweens and sort of congregate in that sort of space or get the catalogs or whatnot.
And are those mostly aimed at girls, those stores?
So yeah. So that's why I think that sort of there is a, because otherwise it gets framed as sort of boy culture. There's a sort of, I think that the tween niche does get very gendered. Your sort of perspective on that component.
Yeah, I think it's a interesting question. So on the one hand, yeah, tweens are just categorically girls, right? Like the word kind of always means preteen girls and not preteen children. But it's also interesting that the word itself is about ages and not about genders, right? And so there's this slippage, and when you look at what marketers are trying to do, on the one hand, it's clothing and makeup and music and these things that very much are targeted to girls. But there are these other moments where it seems like maybe they actually don't realize and they think they're selling to older kids. But so the question of sort of who is the tween, what's the stereotype of the tween, I think malls are important, right? White, suburban, middle class girls. And so there's this other logic where we have a word that means an age range, right? If it means 8 to 12 or 6 to 11 or something, that seems, that's supposedly that encompasses everyone, but what the sort of the image of the type of person that stands in for that is a white middle class suburban girl. And so then if you're not a white middle class suburban girl, the consumer industries aren't necessarily directly targeting you and you might not fit into that as well. Or you might be outside of it entirely, right? Like malls, you know, stores at malls may not be a space where you're welcome or that's even available to you. And so then one interesting question is what if tweens are categorically girls with these sort of racial and class markers too, is like what exactly is going on with 8 to 12 year old boys, right? Like in some ways may be sort of outside of this discourse about age and consumer culture and media.
Right. Yeah, although I do think it's funny. I think that there is a world that gets created sort of from the marketer advertising side in terms of what the stereotypes of tweens are. But just from sort of my experience in television, that doesn't necessarily look like that. That tween sort of sitcoms in television are very remarkably culturally, racially diverse in the US. So there is sort of one thing I think where advertisers, you know, catalogs, magazines are shifting in certain ways. And I think that that's pushed, especially nowadays, by young people who are online, who have sort of their own messaging about what a tween or a teen or a girl might look like. And sort of a kind of a change that may be driven from sort of the mass-produced, you know, fictional content does kind of shift some of that, what a tween might look like as well.
Can you give us some examples of like some fictional representations of tweens like on TV that were particularly important if you feel like in sort of making that happen?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think during my time at Disney Channel, I would say that That's So Raven, actually Raven Simone, I see some nods, was actually a pretty, she was, I think she was the first African-American lead sort of female character on the show, but she was also hugely sort of commercially successful, kind of pulling on some of her past sort of notoriety from like the Cosby show and sort of other shows. But she was also from the get-go about her musical talents, her fashion talents, sort of all the other ways in which she had a sort of entrepreneurial sort of bent to the kinds of things she was interested in. And I do think, at least from kind of within the network, sort of thinking about who could be a leading, who could be a star, who could be sort of the centerpiece of a franchise, because tween culture is nothing if not franchisable and rebootable and evergreen, the themes, the content. So I think for me that for all the shows that now, if you go to like DisneyChannel.com, you'll see sort of a very pretty wide array of who's for now Zendaya sort of being a lead sort of actress and star of not just Disney but ABC, Dancing with the Stars, like the whole sort of world of the Disney ABC sort of franchise. So I think for me that was a, but again, it tied to sort of like the market logic. It's not out of like kindness or necessarily out of sort of inclusion, although that is, shifting on ABC kind of as a whole, sort of what shows are getting produced and greenlit there. But I think sort of the market logic behind it underpins it all.
So kids media, kids TV especially, right, I think deserves a lot of credit for diverse casting practices going back to the 90s and Nickelodeon. I think there's no question about this, right? Right now, we're sort of finally starting to see primetime TV shows with actors of color in lead parts or even just in prominent parts, and that's something that people are celebrating. And it's definitely true that the Disney Channel and Nickelodeon had that 10, 20 years ago. There's also this the sort of Disney Channel casting logic is this kind of like flat multiculturalism, right? So you have your casting is kind of nominally diverse, but it's also, for starters, still suburban and affluent, right? Like that's the kind of cultural center, and to some extent, and not always, but to some extent, it treats ethnicity or race as kind of just this sort of flat, interchangeable thing, like other sort of forms of consumer taste or something, that it's not necessarily that things like race and ethnicity are not sort of historical or kind of structural, class divisions, right, that affect the way people relate to each other, that structure people's relations to each other. They're just these sort of incidental characteristics of a character, right, in a school or something who might relate to each other's. So I actually am totally on board with sort of celebrating kids media, kids TV especially, for doing things that primetime TV is being celebrated for 20 years later. But there's also a sort of, I think there's an interesting way that the sort of logic of multiculturalism kind of still It is invested in a kind of racial logic that ultimately I think is still kind of white, right? It's sort of multiculturalism gets subsumed into. I think that's a complex argument, and I don't need to sort of make it right here.
I have an idea, though, to clarify. Dora the Explorer. Yeah. I feel like this is an argument that gets made about Dora the Explorer. That yes, it's great that there's a kids program with Spanish and all this stuff, but where is Dora from? Like, she has no cultural specificity whatsoever. She has no traditions. She has no geography. She has no. It's a completely blank what her ethnicity really is.
Well,
it's
and like on the, you do have shows on the Disney Channel. And I'm blanking on the names, but where you do, you also, if you have a Latino lead, they have a Latino family, and there may be maybe references to heritage and things like that, right? So it's not
as perfectly, bad as Dora.
Right, it's not as bad as Dora, absolutely.
What do you think, Meryl?
So at Nickelodeon worked on sort of the next iteration of Dora, but called Ni Hao Kai Lan. So it was sort of a Mandarin Chinese focused version of. Not of Dora, but a lot of the same producers. And TV is messy to put together. Yeah. And there is a lot of, just from the get-go, the globalization of children's media as like a huge market. It's not to sort of be understated like how much money, how much of the financial models are sort of pinned on this. So, you know, the sort of pan representation of being Latina fedora is partly sort of a an adaptation of what cultures sort of make sense for the episode, like what cultural components make sense for an episode, and what so for sort of advancing a singular episode or a story versus sort of the entire narrative arc and world of Dora's sort of identity. But again, sort of the, again, where the market sort of comes up here is the show that I was on was canceled ultimately because it couldn't sell as many toys as Dora could. So so there's that sort of, and having sort of, we had Chinese cultural consultants, Chinese language consultants. I ran studies with preschoolers, with kind of workshopping all the cultural content in Chinese preschools in the San Gabriel Valley. So there was like a great deal of effort and work that went into the specificity of the language and the sort of dialect and all of that sort of stuff. So people are, I think, at least on the preschool side, I think trying to do something with what they've got to work with.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And somehow, and the specificity didn't sell as well as the sort of every girl-ness of Dora. Is that the idea?
I don't know the all the exact reasons in terms of population or interest. As you know, but I should say that then the one of the writers from that show went on that I worked with went on to be the creator of Doc McStuffins, which is a preschool, I see some nods, a preschool show on Disney that is very important in the sense that it, the lead character is a girl, African-American girl, who's a doctor, which there's underrepresentation in STEM and medicine fields with women of color. And I think that there's a lot of values that if that doesn't kind of come through in one show, then you know you try something else. Mm-hmm.
Doc McStuffins' mom is a doctor. Doc McStuffins is a stuffed
animal. A toy doctor.
Yeah,
right. There's no liability there. But when kids, you know, when they put on, they carry the Doc McStuffins sort of bag and, you know, the coat. For all intents and purposes, they're a doctor.
I really love this point, though, that it's a complex point, right? It's because on the one hand, you guys are saying children's culture kind of led the way, and which is really striking because we often think of children's culture as retrogressive, as nostalgic, as backward-looking, as lagging behind the aesthetic experimentation of adult art.
Which it also is, interestingly, right? Like, there's, like, if you watch shows like Hannah Montana, their format is this, like, golden age of TV sitcom format, right? So it's more like The Honeymooners than Modern Family.
So I can
Really,
well, I can partly explain that because the writers of kids' TV shows, it the sort of running joke was you either get them sort of on their way up or on their way down. So either people who are sort of cheaper to pay because they're sort of fresh out of college or they, you know, are newly employed, or people who used to write for sitcoms that were canceled maybe 10 years ago and the residuals are kind of running out. So kind of on the way up or on the way down are the folks who are mostly writing children's television.
I think there are also interesting aesthetic arguments for why it happens and not just, I'm not sure what they are. But anyways, just as a side note, it, like some of this stuff also is a sort of archive of like, of sort of genres and styles. Yeah, but I think the point about diversity and other things that it also can lead the way in important ways.
Yeah, it's really interesting. And what about, so I know a lot of people in our culture are really worried about the way kids are getting sexualized, especially girls, like younger and younger. I'm wondering how that sort of fits into these shows and also to pop music. So Tyler, your expertise on popular music, what do you see differences in the way tweens, girl stars, and tween boy stars are sort of treated in that or other regards?
That's a lot of questions.
I know, sorry. I guess what I'm asking is how does pop music compare with
so
television?
Actually, to go back to, maybe there's a, I think there's an interesting conceptual point about tweens and the idea of sexualization and a sort of, there's a cultural discourse about the sexualization of girls at a younger age.
Right.
So also thinking about why tween is a label that sort of applies to girls and less to boys. And I think one way to think about this is that the idea of being between childhood and adolescence is a in our culture and in the sort of way that gender works in our culture is a problem for girls in a way that it's just not for boys, right? So transitioning from childhood, which is at least culturally constructed in terms of ideas of innocence, and innocence specifically as like asexuality, right? The absence of sexuality. And then there's some sort of, you know, black box, and you come out on the other side as a sort of sexually mature, you know, sexually desiring and also sexually desirable person. And the issues there, right, are just so much heavier for girls, in part because our culture is kind of obsessed with girls' sexuality, with sort of girls as sexual objects, and both with making that something that is a widespread kind of like desire, and also that desire turns into a discourse of kind of concern, right? So so it's a problem for girls, and so then we get new words because we're trying to sort of like resolve a problem to some extent, and so something like tween, like naming this and trying to make sense of it, oh, you kind of are a teenager, but you still kind of are a child, right? Like, let's combine the sort of playfulness of childhood with the with some of the markers of youth culture, which are things like fashion and music and whatever else, right? Like, then it doesn't necessarily resolve it, but at least kind of presents a package that says, like, this makes sense, it's intelligible, it's not, you know, it's not a contradiction anymore.
Can I just ask you, so you said it's more of a problem for girls. How does that play out with, say, comparing someone like, and you don't have to use these examples, but like Miley Cyrus and Justin Bieber? We had to get to them, right?
Well, right, but so it's, I think it's, the first point is that it's a problem that like members of the culture understand as being an issue for right? Like people think about 11-year-old girls and they feel anxious, right? Like they don't know how to process it. They have this sort of like combination of, you know, this like virgin horror thing starts to apply, and like, what does it mean to have this person be a sexual object, or maybe to be presenting themselves as sexually desiring, any number of things, right? And that just, that doesn't apply to 11-year-old boys, right? Like the kind of cultural construct of an 11-year-old boy, the image we have of an 11-year-old boy is very different.
What, like Tom Sawyer or something?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Any number of things.
Okay.
So I think for it's less the celebrities, right, than the sort of the word itself and the way we think about maturation. There's a whole kind of argument about what does happen for boys, but I mean, just the sort of simple point is that I think we can see that people are concerned about that for girls. And so then you do get weird things, right? Like the Jonas Brothers had this thing where they'd wear promise rings, and so they were sort of like saying, yes, we're virgins, we're gonna stay virgins. But like, men don't have that virgin whore thing applied to them, so you don't have male celebrities who might be objects of like their fans' sexual desire have to say, oh no, I'm still a virgin, right? You don't have that. But then in this weird like tween media environment, you have the boys like really going out of their way and kind of voluntarily taking that on, which I don't know if, which is, I think, an interesting problem, right? So it's not performing traditional sort of masculine celebrity, right? Which might be more kind of aggressively, you know, desiring and other things. And instead, kind of putting themselves in a position that in the past would have been reserved for girls. Whereas the kind of the forms of femininity that someone like Taylor Swift or Hannah Montana are performing are much more conventional and traditional, right? I think you can see them as being pretty conventionally sort of like modest, but still sexualized, right? Kind of proper femininity.
Yeah, I was thinking, when you guys were talking about consumption, I was remembering when my son one time wanted to watch the Miley Cyrus show. What was this? That's the Hannah Montana show.
Yeah.
And we turned it on, and she and another girl were having a huge fight at the mall over a pair of shoes. Who was going to get to buy the pair of shoes? And I was just like, oh my God, I don't want to watch this. I don't want my kid to watch it. Because it was so about consumption and fashion and superficial stuff. I don't know. What's your take on this?
Yeah. So I guess from the inside, we're sort of this experience. So I will say, so one thing about a sort of off-the-record development executive said to me, in trying to sort of create more progressive shows, a sense of frustration of like, I don't know why I like spent all of this time going through being a development, you know, a assistant at an agency to then like a development assistant to like working my way up the like the development chain, which is kind of how it tends to work in Hollywood, just so consumer products could tell me what to green light. The real sort of dictation of if it doesn't get pitched in the room with a whole suite of materials, then it's likely not going to get sort of greenlit. So of course that ends up, but of course at the same time though you still have, you know, rules how kind of up to date they are from the FCC about the kinds of marketing that can be done on television and can't be done and in what sort of order, and you know, you can't technically have, although Hannah Montana I don't think is on the air anymore on Disney Channel, they've moved on to some other other shows, yeah. But you know, you couldn't have a Hannah Montana, a spot for a Hannah Montana like CD within the Hannah Montana episode, because that would become a program length commercial. Of course, like you could say sort of the whole channel is sort of a 24 hour commercial. So sort of whether or not it's sort of Hannah Montana in the episode, but there are people who like, who it's their job to like painstakingly, because there's huge fees attached to that if that ends up happening. So people whose jobs it really is to like sort of check every little element that goes. My specific job when I was at Disney Channel was program scheduling coordinator, which meant that I managed the grid of every single thing at every single time that was on Disney Channel, and like in a database would like program and plug in episodes. Like the programming sort of executives would decide like, this is when High School Musical 2 is gonna premiere and these are all the episodes that are kind of gonna go around it. But the rest of the time you put on what you're gonna put on. So sort of managing like which of those episodes would come in. But this ties us back to sort of the sexualization discussion, because the Disney Channel stars then leave the nest at a certain point and go on to more teen or adult careers. I think you had mentioned something earlier about sort of there were like moments where we're like, oh, something happened, and that's, you know, there's sort of like a breakage. So it was pre-Miley, it was Lindsay Lohan that sort of was the sort of tipping point of who represents sort of the brand, who has sort of gone too far in terms of no longer being representative of what the Disney sort of brand represents in terms of not just sexuality, but then also sort of drugs and alcohol and sort of other other behaviors too. But I have a vivid memory of having to scrub, having to pull the Parent Trap from having aired like one night because like something had come out in the news and everybody at sort of Disney Channel was sort of a flurry that we had to put some other movie on that night because it would look really bad to have the Parent Trap, the Lindsay Lohan version, not the like Hayley Mills version, for people in the room who know what that is, on the television that night, because it would be a not a good thing.
Wow. That's really interesting.
And not just after they leave, right?
Right.
So like Miley Cyrus had the Vanity Fair shoot and the mm-hmm. sort of pole dancing thing,
right.
All of which were sort of overblown, right? We live in a culture that's like looking for ways to freak out about girls, images of girls. And Vanessa Hudgens had mm-hmm. these photos like while she was still affiliated with Disney.
Yeah.
But going back even further in the 90s when you had the sort of boy band and teen pop explosion in the late 90s, which was not coming from the Disney Channel and Nickelodeon, but was definitely very interested in young audiences. You had Britney Spears and NSYNC and these other, they would be on the Disney Channel all the time.
Although
right? They did start at Mickey Mouse Club, right. And then they went away for a while. But they aired on Radio Disney, but they also aired on Top 40 Radio, right? Which was not true for Hannah Montana or High School Musical. But you had the Nickelodeon and the Disney Channel like really wanting to have these acts on because they attracted their core audience, right? So if you could have a Britney concert on the Disney Channel, that was perfect for Disney. But that was a real sort of contradiction, right? On the one hand, you really want it. It's exactly what your audience is looking for. But after a year or so, Fox Kids and Nickelodeon and Disney Channel all sort of started backing off away from Britney, who well before 2006, 2007, she started having her kind of Lindsay Lohan style public drama, was seen as kind of too provocative for the kid audience. So there's this real kind of tension where it's precisely that like teen, youth culture, like kind of provocative, eventually highly sexualized imagery that kind of, that is what sells, right? And is what you sort of want to put on screen, which is why you have these stars like Vanessa Hudgens or Miley Cyrus who can sort of be getting into trouble at the moment that they're still kind of kids stars, is because you're always straddling that line. And they sort of just constantly are going back and forth, right? Be kind of pushing up against the line and then backing off against the front.
Yeah. Although I think it is really important if we're, you know, talking about not just tween culture from sort of 10 years ago, but tween culture sort of at the moment and the ways in which, you know, young women who are stars of sort of Disney Channel shows are themselves on social media, are Rowan Blanchard, who stars in the show Girl Meets World. There was just a New York Times article on like her definition of feminism and like how she, I think, identifies as, not necessarily heterosexual, not necessarily sort of conforming to sort of gender binaries, that she, has sort of made sort of certain political statements. I think we're in a sort of different space in which that is not, I don't think, kind of controlled in the same way that the Disney machine had been operating, and that sort of relationship between, and you have sort of also celebrities now, like Amanda Stenberg and Willow Smith, who maybe became famous as sort of tweens through, like Willow Smith, is her parents are Will Smith and Jada Pinkett Smith. But you have then also Amanda Stenberg, who was Rue in the Hunger Games sort of series, as they sort of enter a little bit older, becoming engaged in Black Lives Matter, engaged in sort of Black girl magic, sort of themes and creation of material online. So using some of that tween notoriety to redefine what it is to be sexual, what it is to be to identify as a girl or not identify as a girl or not identify as any particular gender either. That there's this dialogue, I think, that today's teenage stars of tween sort of media are sort of bringing and pushing some larger cultural conversations, not just in sort of the youth space, but sort of the larger cultural space overall.
Really cool. That kind of anticipates my next question, which was going to be, you both work on technology, and I was thinking that technology is one way that kids have a way to communicate with each other and make connections and engage in activism that maybe wasn't so easy in the past, potentially. I don't know. So I'm interested to know what you guys think in terms of how technology fits in, what role it plays in sort of the category tween.
So the number one technology that I think has been on my mind for the past few weeks is Musical.ly. Do people know that app? People sort of nods. Maybe you sort of know about it because it's sort of a musical. Okay, so it is where if you know an 8-year-old, they might be on it. It is, of course, social media when it comes to being age 13 and up. That's what sort of one is supposed to be that age, but there's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10-year-olds, that sort of band on Musical.ly. It's an app for lip syncing, but it is a lot like Snapchat. And it does not ask you what age you are when you sort of create a profile. There's celebrities who have their own kind of profiles on it, but also just people who are, instead of YouTubers, they're musers. And so they have their own followings, people who are primarily Musical.ly, like on the app famous, who then become one of the musers, just got signed by CAA, and I think she's like 13 or 14 or something. So there are these spaces that were not considered to be sort of social networking spaces, but because there's certain gray areas in terms of having to be regulated by the FCC, by sort of those regulatory bodies, that sort of tweens are finding spaces to connect with one another and to express who they are, express their identities, to collect. I think this is also like an important identity development, and that is certainly an, sort of a teenage something that happens in sort of those years. But there's also the sense in sort of the sort of age band, 8 to 11, of like collecting and sorting and sort of amassing and using that sort of as you go along to figure out what you are. But sort of, you know, that's why like baseball card collections or whatever sort of collection,
Pokemon,
whatever it sort of is, the sort of amassing and then kind of as you move through like sorting and getting and rid. And so you can like follow a lot of people and then unfollow them if you want. But that's sort of part of the new collection, is like following a lot of people and like having them on your feed. And that is now, because so many young people have, so more teens have phones, but more tweens have tablets, in terms of like what are these, some of these distinctions between teens and tweens. But like the 8 to 11 band, I think it's spend about 6 hours a day with media. But teens, it's closer to 9. So you do have sort of some gaps here. But TV is the number one technology still among that tweens are, 8 to 11 year olds are engaging with.
And do you
so not to overplay sort of the high tech social media stuff, that TV and music are still number one.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that this is, I think it's so striking, so we've been talking about tween culture now for 45 minutes, books have not come up, says the literary critic, which is partly a feature of what you guys are interested in.
Well, no, we talked
in,
about Hunger Games.
That's true. Brief passing mention. But it does seem to me interesting that a lot of the action, I feel like, seems to be happening more in these other fields of cultural production. Is that fair or right, do you think?
Well, I mean, I do think, I mean, book series like Hunger Games, like Divergent, that those are, I mean, they're transmedia franchises.
Right, but they're not tween. I think of them as teen, and because it's not that tweens don't read them, but I don't think they're culturally marked as tween phenomena.
Well,
I think
also, the publishing industry
YA,
doesn't use, but
right?
The publishing industry doesn't use the term tween, it uses YA,
well,
right?
Well, that's right, yeah.
And yeah, that's its own interesting question, or middle grades, which is, is what's the relationship between those?
Right. Like as an industry, it's not invested in tween.
But yeah. But I think there's also, like, genres and mediums are not equally distributed, right? So, music, popular music especially, has very strong associations to youth culture in particular, right? And so it's reasonable to expect, and it in fact I think is the case, that that kids would be invested in certain types of media and not other types of media, right? Mm-hmm. And these things can be divided by gender, so in the 80s when you had the sort of half hour program length commercials, the He-Man and Smurfs and these other shows that were kind of developing a kind of new form of kids' TV, when the developers of these TV programs were looking to target somewhat older kids than the young kids who would watch He-Man, the shows that they produced were Jim and the Holograms and Barbie and the Rockers, right? Like these music-focused shows, whereas like the Smurfs or Rainbow Bright, these aren't music-focused shows. So you're trying to target older kids, which means tweens, right? And you bring in music. In the 90s, Nickelodeon and the Disney Channel and Fox News were all in this competition to get older kids.
Fox
and
Kids, you mean?
What did I say?
Fox News.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. Well,
that's
601.
And
what did they do? They went after the tween pop stuff, right? And they started putting NSYNC and the Backstreet Boys. And so music as being as having strong associations with youth culture, with teenage culture, and the logic of tween is trying to somehow integrate youth culture with childhood, and sort of mix and match them and make them make sense. It makes sense that music especially would be one of the most visible and prominent.
But also, it seems like historically the rise of tween as a category is coinciding with the rise of new media, right? I mean, that 1968 Micro Boppers article is all about Marshall McLuhan and the rise of television and like new kinds of technology. So I feel like they're aren't they developing kind of at the same time?
There's lots of things that are developing, you know, to make like kind of spurious correlations between sort of one or the other. I mean, you also have things like, family, divorce rates, You know, what does a family look like? What does the home life look like? You know, you have sort of a sort of spike sort of in the 80s, but now we're at a point where like divorce rates are about the same as sort of around World War II sort of era. So you have sort of shifts in just what family is, economic stability or instability. Families nowadays that are increasingly, because globally diasporic families, so young people that are trying to connect with loved ones who don't live not just in like the same town, but the same country, and so what those tools are for connecting. So some of these like broader, you know, kind of sociological frames around like what does it mean to grow up within a certain time period, and there are certain tools available for other kinds of connection. And your, you know, your phone can include, you know, Skype or whatever it is to connect with somebody else, and it has all this other stuff too. So all of those things our technologies do so much, but always in relation to some of these broader themes that aren't just about impacting tweens, but impacting the sort of social spheres in which they live.
And also, like, there's a whole long list, right? Like the sorts of places where people live, changing neighborhoods, policies where we've actually like criminalized in a lot of cases, kids playing by themselves on streets, the decline of things like malls, right? Which sort of replaced neighborhoods for a while as a kind of semi-public space where kids could congregate independently. And so to some extent, media is just a kind of like small replacement for, you know, the public spaces that have all been taken away, the decline of neighborhood schools, all sorts of things.
But I think it's really comforting to think about the ways in which media can link people together and maybe give teens and tweens who are marginalized a way to find people that they couldn't necessarily find. Could you speak to that?
Well, and at the same time, though, so just talking about musically, like, yes, we can sort of say that there's like new connections, new communities, but then thinking about the biases that are built into any of these systems. So I was just going through musically with my students in my mobile communication class, and there was like there's a hashtag for like face filters where you could, you know, just like Snapchat, where you could, you know, change your face like a little look while you're using the front-facing camera to kind of go into the phone. So again, this is an app that is largely being driven by sort of this like 5 to 11 sort of age range, younger than we might think of as social media. And I pull it up, and one of the face filters is like a kabuki sort of like mask with like a fan. So we have sort of yellow face going on in this setting where mostly unsupervised 5 to 11-year-olds are hanging out. So awesome friend making, not so great cultural stereotypes, cultural appropriation, and a definite sort of outlook that might not be a thing that, you know, kids a little bit older or, you know, even the kids themselves might choose to encounter, but it's in the neighborhood that they're hanging out in. So I think that the sort of, you know, belonging, not belonging, there's ways that these technologies create that code that into their very being. And so the sort of, it's awesome, it's terrible, all at the same time is important to hold on to.
I was thinking about like it's something like It Gets Better, right? The phenomenon where you can, maybe there is no one in your town who is supportive of you as a queer kid growing up, but you, through the internet, have access to these messages or something.
And the flip side of that is the sort of, you bring the bullying home, right?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, one of the kind of consistent findings over the last 10 years of, or more of research about new media and kids is that, or social media and kids, is that that most of the people that you're linked to on social media are people that you know face-to-face, right? And so there may be opportunities, and probably more for somewhat older kids, right, to make connections, or to be members of affinity groups, right? Like if you really like fantasy novels or something, you can find a space for yourself.
I'm so glad you mentioned that, because I was thinking, creative opportunities like writing fan fiction and finding a community and a creative outlet, both.
Right. I don't think we're at the point yet where kids really are like developing lots of social relationships that are just online social relationships, right? I still think it's the vast majority of the kind of links, the social links that you have on social media are people that you have some connection to face-to-face.
People you already know.
Yeah.
Very interesting.
Can I make, technology, I think an interesting and kind of another kind of funny and problematic example, Kids Bop is the biggest, one of the biggest music brands, period, but definitely the biggest music brand going with kids' music. So Kids Bop takes top 40 pop music and like re-records it with choruses of kids kind of singing along to the hooks, and packages it in CDs, in compilations, and sells it to kids. And they usually edit a little bit of the language. So it's basically very timely pop music that parents might not want their kids to be listening to, edited a little bit, add some kids' voices, and now it's okay to sell the kids, right? And so, you know, 4 to 11-year-old kids. So Kids Bop, their albums are always in the top 10. Anyways, the point is not Kids Bop, but kidsbop.com in 2006, 2007, through, I think starting as early as 2006, but maybe 2008 to 2010 or 2011, kidsbop.com was set up as a video sharing site for kids. So YouTube also would be a space that was growing at the time, but being on YouTube if you're an 8-year-old kid might be sort of a question, might be problematic. And also sites like YouTube ask for information, personally identifiable information that they're not allowed to ask for of young kids. So kidsbop.com was setting itself up as sort of fitting within the regulations, not asking kids for their personally identifiable information, and then also kind of being the safe neighborhood space. And they were encouraging kids in particular to record themselves performing, right, sort of like musically, and to post these videos and share, and they'd have contests and all these other different things. Kidsbop.com, that version of kidsbop.com abruptly disappeared in like, it's like hard to date, but in like 2011, I sort of looked away for a minute and all of a sudden it wasn't there. And Kidsbop retooled itself as a celebrity-driven brand where now they cast kid performers, whereas previously they always just hired studio singers to re-record the songs, just sort of anonymous adult voices singing the leads. Now they have, you know, consistent named celebrity kids, like on the Disney Channel or something, right? Sort of who are celebrities that they're trying to promote as celebrities. They have these kids go on tours, so they're trying to sell concert tickets, and they no longer have the idea of like kids sharing their performances with other kids and having a community of performance. And that didn't work, right? Like kidsbop.com has always been successful, but it's much more successful with this kind of old media, celebrity-focused, album sales model than it was with a kind of new media YouTube style, peer-to-peer sharing-based based model. And I think we can learn lessons from stuff like that, right? Like that there's not always a perfect alignment between kind of kids and whatever the next technology is. Kidsbop thought maybe YouTube and kids would be perfect, and if they invested in it, somehow it would turn into the thing that would solve the problem.
Well, and also that the sort of the idyllic notion that I was sort of floating for you guys, that kids are using these to communicate with kids and express themselves creatively, tends to often get shut down or managed or controlled, sure, or appropriated by adults.
Yeah. Well, no, and especially in sort of school settings, you know, that sort of what are the computers here for? What are, you know, what's the goal here? With the knowledge, of course, that there's plenty of young people for whom the internet is only something that they're able to reliably access, maybe at a school or at a library and not at home. Mm-hmm. And so those same sort of pathways to all the skills that we know, not just technological skills, but social skills, cultural skills, skills like critical, you know, thinking about, you know, sources of information you come across, the ways in which any of those spaces are not equally sort of aligned. But to go back to something that I realized I hadn't really brought up before, but even just sort of talking about tastes between a certain age band, that in my work I've been really interested in what ways sort of the notion of age-appropriate media can be complicated by issues around, you know, things like disability and cognitive development, different domains of development of young people who don't necessarily fit the sort of ages and stages model that marketing is meant to sort of be geared towards. So I've been studying kids on the autism spectrum and, you know, different interests or engagements that they might have. And you can have both a 3 and a 13-year-old who love Elmo or who love cars. But as you age older, you're not gonna necessarily find the Elmo sneakers that fit. You're not gonna find the materials that are intended for sort of an audience. But those are that's still sort of within that biological age range, something that somebody loves and somebody's into and that somebody's identity is sort of in relation to. So there's these, you know, self-organizing, you know, groups or spaces where young people can feel like they belong. So there's a group of young people who are on the game Minecraft, which is a very, we can't talk about tweens and sort of, you know, culture without talking about Minecraft, I don't think. But there's like a server on this sort of Minecraft being this online sort of networked blocky sort of game where it's like Legos, but plus like Second Life, I guess, if you're gonna like throw, if Second Life rings a bell to people. But, you know, a virtual sort of space of building and creativity. And you can play it where you're sort of in like a game mode or kind of a creative mode where there's like monsters and attacking or just sort of cohabitation. And there's a, and you can have a standalone server, a space where you don't have to worry about other people kind of messing up your game, or you can kind of block it off. And so there's a server called Otcraft that is around sort of kids on the spectrum socializing in ways that are most comfortable for them, sharing interests in ways that might be most comfortable, not being bullied by others online, because online bullying with among young people with disabilities is higher than for kids without disabilities. That's across various kinds of disabilities as well. So in what way the internet is a safer, comfortable, or welcoming space for various kinds of difference. And there's certainly adults who have come to organize around those spaces, but it can take a lot of in-person support to and conversations, but those kinds of materials are sort of homespun right now, that they're not really integrated into larger conversations about like child safety or about privacy or about how to engage on the internet and how to benefit from it. So we have, I mean, in the US, 13% of students, 3 to 22, receive some kind of special education services. That's not an insignificant percentage of young people we can say are individuals, you know, that identify as having a disability of some kind. So so my interest has been in this, the whole sort of space in which understanding, because there's been so much focus on sort of a medical view of focusing on sort of these kids as being sort of in special education classrooms or in therapy settings, but not this Mimi Ito and other researchers, the sort of hanging out, messing around, geeking out stuff, sort of mundane, ordinary things. Mm-hmm. And so I've been really interested in, well, what does that mundane, ordinary life look like for them too? Because that's happening as well. And there's a market if you did kind of dig a little deeper.
Thank you so much. Well, I have to pause and say, if anyone needs to run, now is a good time to make a non-conspicuous exit. But for the rest of you, it is time for your questions. So please go ahead and line up at microphones. While people are filing out, you can come to a microphone and ask a question. Any kind of question about tween culture, teen culture, Marilyn Tyler's research? What have you got?
I'll be brave.
Yay! Thank you.
So lately I've like noticed like there's like a big rise in older, not kids, but like teenagers and young adults who get really invested in like tween-based shows, like something like Steven Universe or Gravity Falls or Adventure Time, stuff like that. And it always makes me feel a little bit weird. They seem to like kind of cater to them now too. And I was just kind of wondering like what your thoughts on that were. And yeah.
So that does have so there is a larger history of the lines between adult culture and children's culture being kind of messy. Pee-wee Herman, sort of Pee-wee's Playhouse, I think is one sort of key factor where there was a show, a sort of camp aesthetic around. And even sort of earlier, I'm forgetting the exact name of the show, but adults who would kind of be, you know, the performers, the lead characters in sort of these variety shows, and there always being sort of a line there between who is this for, who belongs as part of the viewing audience, and people, you know, other kind of identities taking a hold of children's kind of culture for whatever purpose that might be, for some kind of, you know, defining what a group might be belonging to. So sort of short answer is sort of it's not new, but the internet makes things more visible and makes it kind of spread faster and easier to find other people who might kind of share some of that stuff. But the our comfort around sort of where those boundaries are have existed for a while.
And right, shows like SpongeBob and Ren and Stimpy and Nickelodeon in the 90s were pretty consciously Sarah Benet Weiser from USC makes this argument, but we're consciously trying to sort of use adult cool, right? Kind of countercultural, and specifically in the 90s, a kind of like campy gay cool, precisely to make their kids' media a little bit more edgy, and also to alienate true adults. Right. So what you don't want as your audience is actual middle-aged moms and dads, right? Like the moms and dads of in this particular model. And so if you can get some kind of countercultural group of young people to buy into it, right, then that makes it a little edgy and makes it exciting for young kids who also can get the jokes and stuff. And also it marks it as not being culture for middle-aged parents. Being a middle-aged parent has changed a lot in the last generation also. But right, that sort of logic of excluding the least cool, you know?
But is that really right? Because I would think, like, from the production standpoint, I would think you would want the widest possible, like, you'd want to appeal to every single person that you possibly could.
I mean, and yes and no. I think that there's people who work for all these companies are themselves, you know, fans. They're adults who geek out, who fan out, who want to, you know, play a role and play a part. But that's not part of the brand identity. And so you have to up the brand identity above all.
Gotcha.
So there's the money source is nothing if not for that. So it's a sort of tension there.
Right. If you're a network like Nickelodeon, your whole reason for existence is targeting kids, right? So
right.
You don't actually necessarily want to expand out. But also there are the flip side of this, right? Like sort of uncool grown-ups liking kids' media is another version. In the 60s, Lynn Spiegel in her book Make Room for TV points this out. In the 60s, there was a real effort to make TV that was like specifically appropriate for kids because there was fewer broadcast channels and everything was kind of for everyone, right? And that was the idea. So you had local networks. One show on NBC in the New York area was called Kukla, Fran, and Ollie and was this like puppet show and was really just sort of insipid and saccharine and it was a good show, whatever. But it was this puppet show. But the point, the like reason that the show exists is that adults are concerned that kids are being exposed to the wrong things, right? Like the kids love the Lone Ranger. They're happy with the sort of cop and action shows and whatever else. But adults are concerned, and so adults have this idea about what kids should watch. And so then you make a show for kids, and then the NBC was going to turn Kukla, Fran, and Ollie from a half-hour show into 2 15-minute episodes, which is more on the model of kids' TV. And they got all these letters from adults who were like, I watch the show. It's not a kids' show. Why are you trying to turn this into a kids' show? Kind of precisely because the logic of the show is adult values about what appropriate, you know, what's appropriate, and then adults end up watching it, and then adults end up claiming it as their own mm-hmm. and object. So that's sort of the weird flip side, right, of this logic of grown-ups watching cartoons.
Maybe
we're not.
Whatever.
I don't
think we're
anymore.
Actually. Okay. Yeah. I wasn't actually going to talk about Kukla, Fran, and Ollie, but I'll just add that I don't think anyone working on that show conceived of it as being for children in any way. So
okay.
The network had this fantasy, great, but you know, just the kind of dialogue was so adult oriented, and Bert, I can't remember his last name, but the puppeteer was always drunk, and just you know, kind of improvising, and you know, there's just a lot of ridiculously adult banter, not super sexualized or violent or anything like that, but you know, it's obviously just the level of discourse was on an adult level and pretty sophisticated. But what I wanted to ask about was if you could just follow up a little bit on Pee Wee Herman, because I was really glad that came up. And you know, the original HBO special was so patently dirty and for adults. And you know, it was just a show I think he did out in LA, and they happened to put it on HBO. This was back before The Sopranos, before HBO sort of became its mm-hmm. new version of what HBO mm-hmm. was. And then the kid show was working very hard to appeal to children and adults, obviously, and I think the movies as well. But the newest Netflix Pee Wee Herman is somewhere between the HBO special and the TV series, I guess. And I don't even know if that's accurate. I'd like to hear your thoughts on it. But it just seemed really, really not for kids. And kind of everything that was submerged and sort of winky in the TV series is much more out there. And it's like much more aggressively queer than the original was in certain ways, or less queerness is less sort of allegorized and kind of submerged and closer to the surface. So I just wonder if you could talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, I think if anything, it's more sort of that those sort of specials are maybe geared towards maybe young people who were fans of the show who are now older, and so their sort of tastes might be kind of between that original series and the kids series. So I think it's sort of part of this general sort of nostalgia repackaging of, you know, whether it was the sort of Full House, you know, Netflix is, you know, sort of invested in like the Fuller House, you know, sort of remake as well, and we can say whether that is or is not sort of, you know, nobody, I don't think anybody has enjoyed that show as much as like people enjoyed Full House. Although like that's a show that still airs sort of all the time. So the fact that Pee Wee hasn't sort of been sort of airing continuously to sort of maintain that audience of non-original viewers, whereas something like Full House, another sort of Netflix show, Nick at Night has been sort of churning that out. I was at dinner the other night and a parent, there was a kid who was like at dinner with like, you know, two adults who were sort of sitting there, and the girl had like headphones and an iPad, and I was like, oh, it's maybe not like the best setting for that to happen. But then I like took a sneak and I realized that like this like 9-year-old was watching Full House on her iPad, which like I was like, oh right, because that's a current show to her or something. So I think that the that Pee Wee, you know, when we talk about sort of these, who is the market, who is it for, has not been able, and whatever, like licensing, like whether that, because a lot of times whether a show has been sort of repurposed or still re-airs is so much about the music licensing, whether people could get permission or not, and how expensive that could be is like a significant reason why shows kind of come out on DVD or don't come out on DVD or do or don't on Netflix. So no, it doesn't really sort of answer it, but I think the sort of, especially in the Netflix era, you know, we haven't really talked about sort of streaming versus non-streaming, television content, but how young people can access some of that archival material. And so maybe now whatever sort of spaces there are, but then again, it's like, is sort of what was Pee Wee sort of then now sort of certain YouTube, is Tyler, I'm forgetting his last name, but like are there sort of campy, you know, transgressive sort of YouTube stars who are that sort of fill a Pee Wee like space for some young people? And maybe it's sort of, you know, should Pee Wee be sort of collaborating with those folks? Like should that, you know, is that, or does it become increasingly more sort of a separate category that isn't tapped into how young people identify or want to have, you know, conversations with those people at this point, or expect to at least.
And just, I mean, the small point that like what is for kids is usually more about adults than about kids, right? Sort of like edgy, aggressive, or campy, or any sort of humor often is sort of right in the wheelhouse of kids. You know, or think about like Bugs Bunny or something, which might have a very similar logic as Pee Wee Herman, right? And stuff that we see now, you know, early Looney Tunes that now seems like very inappropriate for kids, right? But actually was targeted to and successful with, and also for a wider audience. So that, like that, I think that's an important question too, right? It's I think to some extent more about the wider adult kind of expectations about what is for kids, right? What's appropriate for kids change, and then sometimes we look back and see things as being either as being surprisingly, you know, inappropriate, right?
Yeah.
When at the time they weren't seen that way.
It's interesting, too, to think about, like, I was thinking about a grad student I had at Pitt who was working on Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, and she went to the Mr. Rogers archive and discovered all these fan letters from adult women who were so moved by the message, I love you just the way you are, and would write to Mr. Rogers. And here was this whole audience that we had not noticed. That's not really an answer to your question, but I just thought it was so amazing. I guess it's answering the question about, like, reception, how important it is to actually study the reception and who's responding, because it's not always who you think is responding.
Well, if we want to, I mean, that's like scholars of soap operas were sort of the original sort of innovators around sort of what it, you know, when you have a show that's on all the time and these relationships and storylines that don't appear, you know, on sort of broadcast television and sort of people's identities with that stuff. I think, you know, we looked like soap opera studies as sort of part of that.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to actually pull away a little bit from popular culture and go back to the definition. because I think there's also, although you did say it wasn't a sociological category, I think the word, let's say teen, for instance, you know, when it's when it comes into other cultures, takes on a certain aspirational quality. Mm-hmm. And so in India, if a parent says, I have a teenager, you know that that parent thinks of the teenager like an American teenager. Mm-hmm. Because most other parents would say, oh, I have a 14-year-old or a 16-year-old. They would not describe the child in those terms. So I'm wondering what happens to the word tween if it crosses those sorts of boundaries. I mean, in a way, it is becoming sort of a sociological category, or maybe a political one, maybe a cultural one, I don't know, but it is not just a marketing, it's not just a marketing unit.
Well, doesn't your example sort of prove the point, right? So it's not like a demographic category like kids of a certain chronological age with a certain, you know, economic status and racial status. It is more this set of kind of cultural marketers and cultural norms, right? So I mean, that's certainly sociological, right, in important ways. But I think that's the stuff that words like teenager also, I think, really leads with and tween leads with. Whereas words like preteen might, at least the way they're used, might be sort of have less of the cultural baggage, even though they certainly have cultural baggage, and more like the way that adolescent has all of this baggage around like medicalization and bodies and development, but that has different cultural baggage than teenager does, right?
But I'm just wondering, you know, I mean, as a researcher or somebody who's looking at this and trying to see, you know, what sort of terms might universally apply or have some sort of correspondence across cultures, then you realize that there is no correspondence or very little correspondence. There may be overlap, but really not correspondence. So when a term like tween, let's say, travels across these boundaries, what happens to it? What's the aspirational quality that's attached to it?
I wonder if that also is sort of, you know, that US-ness, if that's part of sort of the buying into part of that culture, and if that is part of like the sort of aspirational, you know, sense. I also think when you say somebody saying I have a teenager versus a 14-year-old, that maybe one of those distinctions would sort of elicit a, I'm so sorry, like, how are you doing? Like, you know, is your life sort of being kind of turned upside down? But that partly being a reflection of a certain characterization of sort of teenage culture as maybe sort of antithetical to community or family values or sort of respect for elders that might be sort of respected and held up as sort of a key component and more collective as opposed to sort of an individualist, you know, spread of that component. And so I think that that all of that, that term, all the stuff that comes with it, you know, as it's localized in some capacity, it always has a sort of global connection, but I think that sort of that those terms, and of course, I mean, part of that also comes down to what the parents might say is, you know, I have a teenager. If that person would when you're asked, who are you? Like, what label do you, how you label yourself? That young person might choose one of many other categories besides that one too. That could be, you know, especially again, sort of very culturally, religiously, you name a sort of identity sort of category, that would be the first one that would come to mind.
But I think a really interesting open question, I don't have any idea. I've seen tween used in like UK and Australian press, right? So I think it has some Anglophone purchase. And there's also a way, like British popular culture seems to like things like that, right? Sort of twee kind
twee,
of.
Twee, yeah. I think that other thing we haven't sort of, it's teen in between, but there's also a twee-ness to it.
But I think it would be really interesting if, because teenager really is this powerful word, right, that has all sorts of reach and is and expanded. I don't think that tween, I mean, even in the States, has the same sort of reach. And I think it's twee enough. My sense is that it won't in 50 years be what teenager is. I think it's a little bit too specific. But
maybe
it would
we'll
be very
back
interesting.
To micro bopper.
Yeah, right.
I think that
I like
would be
micro
better
bopper.
Myself.
Well, do you remember, like, I had a magazine that was, I mean, it did that term did last somewhat. I mean, I think, I don't know if Bop magazine or Big Bop still exists as like, as, but that magazine was like, still when I was like growing up was like in the 80s, 90s was like a thing. I don't know if that magazine title still exists anymore. Mm-hmm. It's like J14, or there's like other like new magazines come and go, but mm-hmm. BOP, you know, did have a time there where it still sort of maintained itself in other mm-hmm. things beyond the 60s.
Well, it makes me think too, your question makes me think about the way in which, like, to say someone is a teenager is to make age a really integral part, like really meaningful. It really determines your identity. It's like when we switched from saying some people have sex with people of other, you know, orientations to saying there are homosexuals. Like there are, it's a category, it's an identity, that's what you are, right? It's almost the same when we say teenager instead of just I have a 14-year-old, we're saying like, we think this age is one of the most salient and important aspects of this person's identity. So it kind of ups the ante on how much age distinctions matter in terms of the constitution of identity, I think.
Right. And also then like what, again, sort of what the market is for that when you've made the category, what you could sell to it now that you've defined it.
Right.
But it's all, I mean, it's interesting, historic, you have adolescent, right, which is this sort of medicalized term, like homosexual, which is circulated and being used for a while before, and then teenager kind of comes in and replaces it, and the one is associated with consumer industries, and the other is associated with like development and bodies and these other things.
Yeah.
And I think with tweens, we have a variety of different words, right? But you know, the difference between like child and kid and other things. There's lots of words that mean lots of different things, right? Mm-hmm. That all sort of still refer to age. Mm-hmm. It's like you can be an age in a lot of different ways.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm curious with the broader definition of tween, so girls and to the extent that this relates to boys as well, where you see this group of people feeling safe and also who you see them trusting. It's a very complicated world that they're all in, and just I'm really curious, sort of across what, you know, whether it's you're saying the malls have gone away, and in some cases it's either the malls have gone away or people aren't letting their kids go to different places because they're helicoptering them or whatever the case may be. But with all these different dynamics that you've discussed tonight, I'm just curious where you really think they're in a place where they're, you know, safe, and again, where they find this feeling of trust.
I'd say the definition is social, so it depends on it's relational. So, I mean, I think there are lots of people who would say that somebody from the outside might say they live in a safe space, but experience sort of bullying and don't have somebody to turn to, and kids who have resources, somebody who asks the question, who notices something different, who notices a kid is skipping, isn't in school much. So you have some kids who maybe have more people who are paying attention to their habits and routines and ones who aren't. And I think that you have some people who, regardless of what's going on in their lives, have anxieties that could be related to what they hear on television about who look like them, what kind of neighborhoods they live in. You know, if you have Donald Trump repeatedly saying that where people live, people don't have jobs and they're not safe and they're, you know, in danger constantly, the sort of internal idea of what that means for your self-worth or self-sense of safety, it's very sort of, whether or not that is reflective of a given sort of child's own sense of feeling well or safe or understood. But I think that the safety component is, to Sonia Livingston, and sort of this is really Anthony Giddens, sort of a risk society that we live in, and sort of in what ways sort of risk and moral, we have the term moral panic, and that hasn't come up the whole time, and I'm like kind of amazed, about what people get worked up about, particularly adults, when it comes to young people's engagement with media and technology. And young people can start to take on that language, you know, when they start to hear people say enough, oh, you know, it's not safe to, you know, be on that social networking site, or it's not safe to whatever. That increasingly has meant that girls then might avoid spaces altogether. So there's that sense of safety being rooted in some idea and not necessarily like statistics, but an idea, and then that leading to sort of barriers of other kinds of entry points. It's not really, wasn't like one direct answer to your question, I realize, but maybe think of all these sort of terms together.
Right. The idea of moral panics, like kind of starting in the 80s, the idea of child safety became a really important sort of cultural topic. And there were important discussions of things like child sexual abuse, but there was also a sort of media-focused moral panic about the idea of that sort of that children were sort of constantly vulnerable to outside threats, right?
Kid on the milk carton.
Yeah, exactly. And so just all of these images of victimized kids, which didn't reflect the sort of, like, in fact, children are much safer and much less susceptible to all sorts of violent and other sorts of crimes than they were a generation ago and a generation before that. Which interestingly moves in like inversely with discourses about child safety and parents especially, right? Like grown-ups in children's lives constantly telling them that this isn't safe, that isn't safe, right? Like walking to school may not be safe, going on the internet may not be safe. So it's an interesting question when a kid feels safe, right? Because they may be being told, like the sort of internet sexual predator is mostly a figment of like ABC's imagination, right? Like it, like you're literally in your room on a device. There's no person there who's, laughing is not quite right, right? But these are not real threats in the just remarkably vast majority of actual kids' lives, right?
Guns are absolutely.
And like the people, the actual people in kids' lives, right? Like family members are much likely to hurt you than a stranger. Or the like real, clear, and present threats are things like everyday bullying, right? Rather than sort of strangers outside. And so I think it's an interesting question: when do kids feel safe? And a lot of that has to do with how adults tell kids whether to feel safe or not. And then going back to the marketing literature, the marketing work, in some of the like marketing research, you get interesting reports about where the sort of category tween, I think a lot of marketers understood it as being just aspirational, right? And so they were sort of very much about pushing the limits. And then market researchers come back and they say, wait, tweens also are invested in sort of safety and comfort and being protected. And so, and you can actually get like 11-year-olds to report to you that they don't want to grow up too fast, right? So it's not just kids always want autonomy and independence. And to some extent in the kind of cultural environment in the 90s and 2000s, you have sort of kids taking on for themselves this language about safety and this language about child vulnerability, and it's hard to separate out that stuff from kind of real is the wrong word, right? But from other forms of safety. So safety is a really fraught idea for children, right?
When you're looking across media at trust, for instance, are they trusting? You know, if you look at is it athletes, is it musicians, is it Dora the Explorer?
It's the people in kids' lives. I mean, I think it's always a good default, and it's usually borne out in research, right? That like that when you're online with people that you know. When you ask about who you trust or who the main influences you have, right? Like the main influences in a kid's life are the people in their lives. And the media stuff is just always secondary to that.
That's kind of comforting, I have to say, as a parent to hear. I think. I also feel like we have to flag Henry Jenkins, who created the Com Forum and who has written so much about this, right? About how.
Including Pee Wee Herman, yeah.
Yeah, about the video games and how, as kids were getting increasingly penned in and told it wasn't safe to go out into the world where they used to rove around, but they could rove around in the virtual space of video games.
My PhD advisor.
Yay! But I also wanted to say, I think also adults' anxiety about new media. Like, I feel like as a parent, I'm often like, I feel bad or anxious that my kid is using, do you know what I mean? And so I feel like there's also a way in which it's not just, I mean, this is not about physical safety, it's more just about like a free-floating anxiety about the media itself and what kinds of effects it has on personal relationships. One of the reasons I love Tyler's work, could you tell them about, just really quickly, about your argument about iPods, about how they are not so much like making you go into yourself, but out sometimes?
Sure. So, actually, cheap generic grocery store MP3 players more than iPods. But I did some long-term ethnographic research in like 2006, 2007, 2008 with some elementary school kids in Vermont. kind of thinking mostly focused on music. And this was when MP3 players were, before smartphones, but were really expanding, and there were sort of more affordable versions. And so younger kids had them and could bring them to school. And what you see very much with kids, and what I think you continue to see, is that when kids listen to music, you know, if you're on the subway or on the bus or and you're a grown-up or you're a college student, you listen to music, you have both earbuds in, right? And you're sort of listening by yourself. And the music, to some extent, is kind of separating you from other people. But with the kids I worked with, it was always the case that you only ever listened with one ear. If you were at home or in the car with your parents, you might listen with both ears, right? Because social relationships, the relationships with the actual people in your lives, are the things that really determine how media exists in your life, right? But if you're in school, if you're in waiting, before school for school, and you were listening to music, it would be with one ear in and the other ear dangling, even though you're
getting, shared with somebody else,
or exactly, right. Or the other ear shared with someone else, right? And most often, so you're always open to talk. You could be sitting at the lunch table. This was at this funny moment before teachers had caught on and banned the stuff. but you could be sitting at the lunch table, listening to, you know, with a friend, while also kind of gossiping and talking with other kids. And I think that's important. And I think the main point of that is less about media and more about relationships, right? Like, relationships are sort of always the first principle of any human, not just kids. And the media stuff is always layered on top of that. And if there's a sort of causal direction, you can kind of start with the people in people's lives. Yeah.
Awesome, thank you. The essay is called "Earbuds Are for Sharing."
Are good for sharing.
Are good for sharing. Yeah.
Hi, I wonder if you could, going back to the idea of the tween as kind of a American culturally specific icon, I wonder if you could talk a bit about that icon in relation to other culturally specific modes of considering adolescence. I'm thinking specifically here of shoujo and shonen in Japanese culture, and I mean, you could talk, I guess, from a marketing perspective, but also maybe from perspectives of kids these age reading, you know, Shonen Jump, for example, is a really, really popular magazine of comics, Japanese comics, that's now quite popular here in America as well as in Japan. And shows like, you know, Sailor Moon or Dragon Ball Z were really popular in the late 90s, and they were specifically marketed when they were created to the shoujo shonen audience, which has a lot of Japanese cultural specificity to it. So I guess thinking about the tween, not just as sort of an American icon, but like with those other international forms of, you know, that age in mind.
Well, just even, you know, mobile technology, you know, far more widely adopted mobile phones adopted in Japan before the US. And so then you had sort of cultures around like kitai and sort of cuteness and, you know, phone accessories and phone sort of objects and uses of the camera phone, uses of, you know, graphics, emoji, or pre-emoji sort of emoticon sort of work. There's a lot that American youth, I think, do not realize that they have, you know, been incorporated that sort of Japanese youth have innovated around cultural identity and personal technologies as well. So at least sort of the mobile aspect I can speak to in that.
I think there's this fascinating cultural influence, right? Sort of the idea, like kitai cuteness in Japanese culture, clearly references childhood, right? But when it gets imported into American culture, it even much more strongly references childhood, and sometimes even stops being visible as Japanese, right? And becomes just sort of cuteness,
the sort of odorless, the culturally odorless
But even, I mean, going back, things like Voltron was clearly modeled on Japanese animation. A lot of those sort of 80s shows, or things like Power Rangers for sure, but also the Racer one, Speed Racer, right? So there's a long history of American animation, especially sort of borrowing from Japan. I'm not sure. There are other forms. I mean, so now just sort of listing forms of cultural influence, but like somehow I think there's also something that's happened where now sometimes culturally specific markers of Japanese-ness can get coded as childish, right? Because in Japan,
Sanrio.
There's a sort of, yeah, absolutely.
Hello Kitty. But then also Hello Kitty has her own sort of, there's also adult component. We won't go there, but that's a thing too.
So then the question of sort of specifically tween, right? So one thing that also didn't come up that I think is interesting about the category tween is that it sort of started as kind of further segmenting the kids market, right? Sort of like creating new segmentations. But then it really became kind of dominant and started to spread outward. So media or consumer culture produced for tweens, which was always seen by marketers as being like older kids, right? Not the preschool set, then can be something that preschoolers can kind of aspire to, and then the tween stuff can kind of get coded young. And or in 2007, this kind of peak moment of tween culture, you had like High School Musical, which was sort of aged somewhat young, and Hannah Montana kind of in the middle, and the Jonas Brothers somewhat older, so you could have like a 15-year-old and a 4-year-old all loving music from the same TV station. And so but getting back to Japanese culture, things like Pokemon, right, like really problematize these age boundaries. Rather than like really investing in the strong age divisions, you can buy a stuffed toy to snuggle with, and you can also play an expensive video game, right, that a 6-year-old couldn't play, but a 14-year-old can.
There's a Pokemon club at MIT,
right?
For MIT students.
Right, and everything is different now. Yeah. Like we're past the tween moment and living past the Rubicon. This is all history. But so I think there are really interesting things going on about the way specifically Japanese sort of cultural products both like emphasize childishness but also break down some of the boundaries, categories that we think of as existing in children's culture.
I will say one thing that I like wish like we could borrow, but part of this also, we haven't talked about this either, but sort of the funding models for children's media and culture. So, you know, you have a robust sort of national funding for children's, you know, media in Japan, that you have a hemorrhaging, a sort of long-term undercutting of sort of public television in the U.S. But I was at something called the Prix Jeunesse, which is like sort of this every 2-year sort of children's television festival. And Japan had the most awesome preschool television. It was like design thinking oriented, and it was like beautiful, and the music was rich, and so we just like made me kind of sad that like we don't have that, and I like wish I could like import it and like spread it around, because there's like really wonderful innovations. And that, but again, this sort of partly goes down to what is sort of the funding models for any of this stuff, and then what gets prioritized under that financial model.
And I think it's really important to say in that regard that here in the United States, we did have federal funding for children's TV, right? With Sesame Street was partly federally funded, and all these amazing programs, Zoom, all these PBS programs, and just how sad it is that that funding, which was aimed at really good social justice goals, has really drained away.
I mean, there's still stuff, like all is not lost, but you know, thinking about, but I mean, so much of that was in reaction to Action for Children's Television sort of campaigning around, again, sort of some moral panic sort of discourse that like funding then got tied to as well. So, but you know, just talking about sort of public television in general, we could sort of get into like what's in the public interest. And what's in the private interest when it comes to content.
Well, also children's music, a lot of the sort of famous children's musicians, most notably Raffi, are Canadian because Canada has artist grants, right? And so a decent amount of the development of children's music is due to Canadian public funding.
Yeah, it's really amazing if you go back and study the beginnings of like Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood and Sesame Street, how they were created by experts in collaboration with TV people. So psychologists, sociologists, like educators, religious leader. I mean, I think it's amazing to look back at that. Like,
but also the developmentalism is so heavy-handed. Sometimes we need fewer psychologists.
I also interned in the education research department at Sesame Street.
Oh, yeah.
So we can talk about sort of the sort of pros and cons of some of that stuff.
Absolutely.
Interesting.
My question was about literature and why you think tween is very much TV and talked about makeup and clothing, but not in children's literature, where it's YA and middle grade and not really tween.
Part of me thinks that sometimes stuff that gets associated with school becomes less part of the sort of leisure time. So just that books, to some extent, have a sort of school connotation. And that's a thing that's always sort of attached to books. And I think just from a leisure purpose, there's somewhat of an inherent tension that will always sort of exist around that.
I think that's interesting, but at the same time, didn't, like, why in middle grade and tween, didn't they kind of evolve kind of around the same time, though? Because there wasn't really a middle grade in YA, like, 60 years ago, or...
Right, so I think it's more, like, kids, different categories are trying to define kids different ways. So it's not that 8 to 12-year-olds don't read, right? Like, I think it's that...
Girls do tend to say that they like reading more than boys.
Sure, right. But also, like, reading is not public, right? Like, reading is something that you do alone and quiet, or at least we do. Yeah, right. Well, sure. So, or when reading is public, the identity that you're performing is student, right? And whereas, like, music listening, you can share earbuds or you can play speakers. Like, the way music as a medium works is more public. But then also just historically, right? Like, music is the TV is associated with the domestic family home, right? Like, TV is not portable the way that music has long been. And so even though TV is important, it usually happens in family spaces rather than peer spaces. Reading happens in school spaces, which are structured by teachers and other sort of institutions. And music listening, music is associated with peer culture, right? So if you have a category that's trying to define people by an age and not by relationship with parents or by relationships with teachers, but by relationships with peers, and to identify with other people who are the same age who might be strangers to you, right? Like, you're 11 and being 11 in certain contexts is salient. And if you live in New York, you and an 11-year-old in Arizona might have that 11-year-oldness in common, right? Whereas if you read the same book, it might mean that you have being a student in common. If you watch the same TV show, to some extent, it means you have the same sort of domestic situation in common, right? Not of course, not always. But so music is, like, structured in such a way to emphasize peer relationships, and not just peer relationships, but also kind of like horizontal identities as chronologically aged. And then also music just historically in the United States, popular music specifically, is the thing that defined youth culture, right? The explosion of youth culture in the post-war period really focused on music, and music was the most visible part of that. And so if you're a marketer and you already have existing models for how to define a new consumer group, demographic, then you would go to that wheelhouse, right? Like, print literature, what defined, like, middle-class women in the 19th century, right? But so, like, you're not necessarily trying to, like, work on that model. You're trying to work on this other model. So I think it actually makes a lot of sense. I think it that's the way music works in our culture.
Do you think the creation of Kappa and kind of breaking people off at age 13, did that help drive the concept of tweens as marketers suddenly couldn't use that media channel to reach that audience anymore?
So just quickly, so COPPA is the Children's Online Privacy Protection Act, which is like 98? Is that too late?
97. It was
And
then it's been revised based on, like, what the internet has become. Like, I think 2013, there you go, was revised to reflect, I mean, that's a long gap, like, a lot happened on the internet between those years, but yeah.
So basically, people were worried about privacy issues on the internet and advertisers collecting information, and so the sort of legislative solution was to really lock down collecting information on children under 13 and have it sort of be totally open for people over 13.
What's that parental permission?
Right. So for kids under 13, a website can't ask them for personally identifiable information without, like, verified parental permission, which really structures and makes it hard to do research on kids under 13, and websites for kids under 13. Either don't exist or designed not to ask for certain types of information.
Because it seems that the rise of tweens is also about that same time.
And there's different genres that come up. So, like, advert gaming is something that does run rampant. You have sort of, you know, the rise of, you know, the sort of McDonald's game, the online sort of, you know, community, or not community, but the sort of branded site. So there's lots of opportunities that, you know, with or without, you know, with COPPA still, that you still have sort of this branded online content that is very much driven towards that sort of community.
I think it's an interesting question. My inclination is that it's more of a coincidence that 13 is a, like, there's a reason that we define tween the way we do, that sort of 13 is a meaningful number.
Although, as you guys said at the beginning, tween is an amorphous term.
Yeah, right, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Right, and older tweens that are not officially allowed to be on Facebook because Facebook collects personally identifiable information from them, but they are often sophisticated enough to lie about their age or even enlist their parents in lying about their age. And so sort of even the COPPA number boundaries are amorphous. But I also think that despite the real emphasis in like the way we talk about media on the internet and new media, I really think that TV and music and old media are more important, not just to kids, but sort of to everyone, that new media, a lot of that is layered on top of it. And so regulating the internet would still be sort of regulating like a second or third kind of tier kind of medium, right? And so, and the things that, like, so I think tween did peak in the late 90s and early 2000s, mid 2000s, but really in music and TV, and the internet is kind of secondary to that. But it is, I think it's a question that's worth following up on, because it does line up in interesting ways, and I would be curious how these companies like Disney and Nickelodeon and other companies that were really invested in targeting this group right at that time and also were investing in the internet, how those regulatory changes may have filtered into their whole strategy, right? And not just their online strategy. It's interesting.
Cool. Thanks.
So do you have a question? Yeah, oh great.
The things you were saying about the app Musical.ly was really interesting. Reminded me of my experiences teaching ninth graders, which is a little older than the tween age bracket. They're like 14, 15, so they're a little past it. And what struck me when teaching them is they were already too old to know like what was cool. Mm-hmm. They were past that point, and it seems to me that a generation of memes or what's considered cool in a media sense, what's popular with music, I'm thinking like the TZ Anthem Challenge, like comes from the tween age bracket. I was wondering if you guys could speak to what tweens generate in terms of what's relevant, especially with like what's relevant on the internet and the new media.
So one sort of genre that is very, I think, tween driven is unboxing videos. If people are familiar with, I see some nods. So unboxing videos, used to actually, I think it started with like Apple products. So like that the packaging was itself so beautiful and wonderful that people then like with this new YouTube around would like unbox on screen, would sort of display all of the sort of gadgets and gizmos and like all the pieces of wrapping and stuff, whatever. But there's this whole hugely financially lucrative a field of unboxing videos. And what those videos are, and it's largely kids who are filmed, and you know, parents are involved in sort of the filming of it, taking like ordinary, not like Apple products, but like Play-Doh or like anything really, and take opening the box on camera and describing all of the bits of it. It is like looking through a catalog that you might, but it's just the YouTube version of that. But you also get added things like there's somebody, a peer who's presenting the toy to you. You get the sensory sort of sounds that are appealing. It sounds like unwrapping presents. There's Jackie Marsh, who's a British researcher who's been doing a bunch of research on this like whole genre. And then you get like adults to kind of piggyback off of Ali's. There's a whole genre of adults who are now sort of making their own unboxing videos that are based on the genre that like tweens were creating to sort of share, the experience of commercialism and sort of belonging. But what's interesting is that you don't have to buy the toy to watch the video. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to go buy it, but there's the window shopping component of it.
It's really interesting because it seems like with the internet with apps, there's this disentangling of tween culture from the financial component that sort of created it in the first place. Because so much of the internet is free. Mm-hmm. Like Musical.ly is a free app, and you can post things on YouTube for free.
Right.
It just seems like there's some sort of freedom there, like beyond financial freedom, just like mm-hmm. they can be themselves and create culture.
Right, but TV is free too, right? I mean, your parents might pay for your cable subscription.
Yeah. Well, free for the kids.
I think we unpack the infrastructure of what gets paid for. But
like unboxing videos are in the same way that TV is just
pay-per-view.
Built entirely on consumer sales, right? That are then being advertised on TV. Unboxing videos are like literally about buying stuff, right? So it sort of depends on a culture of buying stuff. They are amazing. There are these Pokemon ones, like Pokemon cards, where someone will just have like a box of like 1,000 Pokemon cards and just open them and say, here's this one, here's this one there. And it goes on for like 3 hours. They're tremendous.
Yeah. And there's like, I mean, but they're also, I should say, like they're also crossed over where we talked about in I'm teaching a class on youth and communication technology right now. So some of this stuff, the examples are at the top of my head, but there's sort of young people who are then paid by these companies to, I'm forgetting the exact name of there's somebody who's like, a child who's a millionaire, purely based on their unboxing videos. And I'm blanking on the person's name at this point. But that they were then hired by Good Morning America to unbox the new Star Wars, because they had their own kind of cultural cachet and knew there'd be viewership, to come on to Good Morning America and unbox the new, like, Millennium Falcon, like Lego sort of set.
I would say though that if unboxing videos are associated with tweens, then this is evidence for the continued marginality of kids and culture, right? Because unboxing videos are not actually mainstream, right? Like they're this like completely like just bonkers internet phenomenon, right? Like,
but then they appear on Good Morning America.
Yeah, but Good Morning America is always chasing niche things, right? Like they, so on the one hand, yeah, absolutely, right? But on the other hand, so it's the way that the internet, like with meme culture especially, works, like kind of actually depends on having like sort of marginal niches that can generate things that then sort of escape, right? Places like 4chan or something that have their own kind of insider jokes that then escape out. The logic might be similar, right? Whereas you have kids making these videos and then that sort of becomes a genre that leaks out. But more broadly, right, I think the idea of kids' influence in culture and especially media and consumer culture, and so not just tweens, but sort of young people generally, the whole idea of social media as a thing, right, is some of the first examples. Well, so Facebook was Harvard, but in the 90s you had a site, Catherine Montgomery talks about a site called like Bolt or Buzz or Boom or something like that. There was like literally a social site for teenagers, and the whole point of it was about getting teenagers online with their friends and then getting them to be really specific about their consumer tastes and their family and like giving the names of everyone. So it was all about collecting data, exactly like Facebook is. So the idea that young people's peer relationships are really important to them, and marketers and consumer industries can provide platforms for those peer relationships to take place, right? And then extract data from the interactions that happen and use it to then sell consumer products is very much originally a marketing strategy targeted to teenagers and young people, and that's now like the world we live in, right? Like that's this sort of, you know, multi-billion dollar social media world. And so that business model, which now applies to grandmothers and you know, 40-year-olds, was a business model that was developed to target young people. And so then does that mean, I think the actual lesson from that is that peer relationships matter to a lot more people than just young people, and marketers were overemphasizing that with young people, and it's a successful strategy. But another version, another way to think about it, is that sort of young people's investment in peer relationships and sort of and social life and these things has expanded outward to be a sort of like dominant way that media works, right? Whereas in the 80s, media would have really been you and your nuclear family watching TV. In the 2000s and 2010s, there's this idea of constantly sharing, which is this idea of how social relationships work that comes from youth culture, right? The idea of friend itself is really associated with young people. And I think there, or the media mix, right? The idea of cross-marketing. Cross-marketing has happened in lots of, or franchising, right? in lots of industries, but really the sort of like it really develops and becomes mature in things like the sort of toy-based TV shows, the Hasbro TV shows like He-Man or something, where it's really the toy company that's like developing the intellectual property and actually paying to produce and write these things and kind of just handing it over to the network. And then you get things like Pokemon, right, which are these sort of media mixes.
Now you have Pokemon Go.
Yeah, absolutely. But so with cards and with video games and with TV shows and all these other things. And now more and more you have sort of franchising happening in kind of mainstream adult culture, right? Like, is Star Wars adult or not? But things like Star Wars, right, which has like book series and movies and toys and video games and lots of other, or the idea of like celebrities making, like also making movies, so you can sell a CD and you can sell a DVD and you can sell concert tickets and you can sell, you know, the idea of like pop stars merchandising, right? That's a response to the decline of the music industry. You know, merch, t-shirts were not as important to rock stars in the 70s. They existed, but now it's like central to the business model of being a pop star. And I think you can plausibly see that as a business model that develops out of things like the sort of cross-marketing in youth culture, where selling toys and selling and sort of this brand being everywhere. So I actually think there's a really interesting story about how sort of things that are originated in kids' culture expand out in lots of different ways, including unboxing videos.
Yeah?
I was just gonna say, I think it's worth noting that there's a very well-respected kids' marketing research firm called Smarty Pants that every year does a brand study on the top brands that kids love, and they just released their findings for the 2016, and the number one brand that kids in America love is YouTube.
Huh.
More than Disney, Oreo, M&M, Apple, PlayStation, every, you know, brand that you've met. So I would say that it's unboxing is not sort of a fringe thing, it's a very central thing, especially to kids. That YouTube is their number one source for content, and OTT media in general, I would say, is the new TV. So it's worth checking out. It's free. The results of the study are free if you want to check out Smarty Pants. It's like asksmartypants.com. But first time YouTube has ever been number one.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, it's a big deal.
Thank you for bringing that up. Well, I think we should conclude, not to sound too much like a presidential debate person, but I was wondering if we could just end by you each saying a question.
We didn't plan this. This is like
Chris
Wallace.
I know, this is a surprise. Yeah. I'm like the Chris What's a Schmush.
Wallace, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So a question that's still motivating your research about tweens that you're still interested in exploring.
Yeah. For me, it's just, what does it mean to be social? What does it mean to do social? I'm interested in a population of young people, kids on the autism spectrum, who get very often defined as being as having a deficit in social skills or social capacities. And I'm much more interested in how do they make social, how do they do social in their different kinds of environments, and in what way can we build worlds that support kind of a longevity of being participating in some way in the sort of public sphere.
Beautiful, thank you. And Tyler?
I'm interested in like tweens as being kind of a historical moment, like that maybe is in the past, right? Like, so there's still a kind of maybe an analogy to sort of teen culture, right? Like there's a moment in the kind of post-war period when we can see this thing happening, in which like a lot of people were talking about it, in which adults really cared about it. And then it stuck around, right? And the term became important. And so it's the recent history, but the possibility that sort of the tween was a thing that happened,
yeah.
And it like established some categories and some ways of thinking, and definitely some sort of market logics, and those will stick around, but they may not be the same thing anymore.
Yeah. So like, why did it happen then, and what does it mean that it's kind of diminished potentially?
Right.
Yeah. Fascinating. You guys have been an amazing audience. Really. Thank you so much for all your questions.